ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति 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 हरि ॐ. We were seeing the definition of adhyasa by Shankaracharya in his introduction to his commentary on the Brahma Sutras, which is called Adhyasa Bhashya. That means a commentary on superimposition. Adhyasa means superimposition. Now, before we proceed any further, we have to understand certain things. What are they? You see, what is adhyasa? And in adhyasa, we saw that there are three elements. It is Smriti Rupa. That means it will have identity with something which you have already seen. That means a memory or a recollection of what you have seen. It will have identity with that. So it's called Smriti Rupa. Then the locus will be different. It will be Paratra. It will not be the exact place where it has been seen earlier. And it is Purva Drishta Avabhasa. Means it is cognizing the same thing which belongs to the same class of what was seen earlier. Okay, so these three things are necessary. So, we have to now understand what is it that Shankaracharya wants to bring here, which is little unique than others. First of all, we saw that the opponent gave an objection. The opponent gave an objection that because we see the senses, we see the body, we see the mind, etc. So because they are manifest, so they are real. And so how can you say that they are unreal? That was an objection which we saw. Now, Shankaracharya says, here the problem is like the shell and the silver. I have seen silver earlier and I have cognized it and I have the smriti or the memory of silver, and later on I see a silver again. So that is a normal thing. Whenever I see silver again, I understand that this is silver. It is a normal thing. But when I see shell and instead of seeing shell, I cognize silver there, that is not normal. Why is it not normal? Because there is no silver to begin with. There is only shell. And though the cognition of silver in the past was correct, and though the recollection of the cognition of silver was also correct, the fact that I am seeing silver now on shell is not correct. It is not correct. So it is something, though it is manifest, when I am seeing silver in shell, I am seeing silver in shell. It's not that somebody is coming to me and saying that, you see, this is magic and so you see silver. No, by myself I see silver in shell. So the manifestation of silver in shell is correct. It is not something which is not happening. But when I apply rational, apply reason, I do analysis, I find that there is no silver. You see? It's a very tricky situation. I don't find any silver there. So that means there was no silver to begin with. So Shankaracharya says, see, this is an example. When I see that there is the body, the mind and the senses, when I see that, when I experience it, it is correct. But when I understand the identity of Atman and Brahman, or when I realize Brahman, then I see that these things are unreal. So when I see the silver in shell, though it is manifested, so the argument given was, you see, you can see, and so it is real. Because it is manifested, it is real. But if that be the case, then when we see water in mirage, can we quench our thirst with that water? We cannot. Because it is unreal water. Similarly, if I see silver in shell, can I take that silver and make some ornaments? I cannot, because it is not silver, it is shell. So when I do analysis, I immediately understand that it is not true. So there is something called pratiyamanatva. That means pratiyamanatva. That means that whatever is pratiyamanam means that which is manifest. So if something is manifest, immediately you cannot say that it is real, because the unreal thing is also manifest. Along with the manifestation, along with pratiyamanatva, there should be another quality which is abhadyatva. That means it should not be negated. It should not be sublated, non-negatable. So the quality is non-negatability. Abhadhyatva means badhyata, badhyatva should not be there. Means it cannot be denied in any situation. So you see, here we have to understand that it is different from something which is false, completely unreal. What is the thing which is completely unreal, as we saw earlier also? The horn of a hare is completely unreal. Rabbit does not have horn. We say shasha shringa. Shringa means horn, shasha means rabbit. So there is no horn for rabbit or hare. There is no akasha kusuma. Kusuma means flower, akasha means sky. There is no flower in the sky. So this you never see. There is no pratiyamanatva. You don't see at all. Nobody can see a flower in sky. It is not possible. So it is not manifest. So it is never real. So it is straight away unreal. But you cannot call mirage to be unreal. It is unreal. But when you perceive it, it does manifest. It does come into your perception. So how can you say completely it is not real? This is the trickiest part. This is the difficult part. So superimposition, why is superimposition so difficult to negate? Because it is really perceived. It is difficult to negate because when you see, this pratiyamanatva is there. It is there. Superimposition has this quality of manifestation. But reality has to be ultimate reality, or the true reality has to be not only pratiyamana, not only manifest, but also abhadya. Means it should not be negatable. It should not be sublatable. So it should be both manifest and non-sublatable. And in that case, we see that mirage or the silver in shell or our body, mind, senses, etc., this superimposition is negatable. And because it is negatable, it cannot be the reality. But there is the problem. The root of the problem lies there, that it has got half the quality of reality, half the attribute of reality. So it is manifest, but it is not sublatable. It is sublatable. It is not non-sublatable. It is manifest, but it is negatable. So that is why you cannot say that it does not exist. You see, in the same place shell is there, in the same place silver is there. But you cannot say that the silver does not exist, because silver was perceived. So you cannot say that it is not real, because it is perceived. At the same time, you cannot say that it is real, because it is negatable, it is sublatable. When you analyze, then you find that there is only shell, there is no silver. And so we call it anirvachaniya. So adhyasa or superimposition or maya or avidya or ignorance is called anirvachaniya. It cannot be explained. It is sad asad vilakshanam. It is something which is different from sad, because you cannot say it is real. You cannot say it is real because ultimately it is proven to be unreal. But you cannot say it is not real also, because it is manifest. Similarly, you cannot say it is asat, unreal, because it is manifest. At the same time, it is proven to be unreal. So we say that, okay, it is anirvachaniya, it is something which cannot be explained, which cannot be explained, inexplicable, which cannot be described, indescribable, anirvachaniya. So superimposition here means anirvachaniya, and it is satya anrita mithuni kritya. It is the coupling or coming together of truth and falsity. And because it is so, though it manifests, it has no reality. Just like I told you, by water of mirage, you cannot quench your thirst, neither can you make ornaments with the silver in shell. Now, you see, this silver which you saw earlier was true, but the silver which you see in Adhyasa is not true. Is not true. So that means the Purva Drishta thing, the thing which was cognized earlier, the thing which you had perceived earlier, is not the same as the thing which you perceive in superimposition. They are not same. Water you perceive, you quench your thirst, and then you see water in mirage. Though the superimposition is created because of the memory of the previous experience of water, this water which you find in mirage is definitely not the same water. It is not. Why? Because there is no water. So it is only a perception of water. It's only a perception of water. It's not water in reality. So what happens is, though you have seen some thing, you have perceived this thing in the past, and based on that, that Purva Drishta, based on the previous perception, you have this illusion, but this illusion, what you see as illusion or what you see as superimposition, is a different experience. It's a different experience, and it is a new experience. It's a novel experience. So it is called Apurva. Apurva means, though it is Purva Drishta, but it is Apurva, means it has not happened before. It has not happened before. Though you have seen a snake, but the snake which you see on rope is not the same snake as the snake you saw, living snake. So this snake you see because you had seen a living snake. Had you not seen a living snake, then you would never have seen this snake also. So that is the connection. But though there is this connection, yet the snake which you see on rope, because of superimposition, is a snake which is different. And it is a apurva experience. It's a thing which is different and which is novel, which is new. So the definition, though in the definition we say that paratra purva drishta avabhasah, that in a different location we have the perception of what we had seen earlier, but in reality we will understand that the smriti rupa is only given to explain the thing, because what we see is not exactly what we saw. They are different. Okay, they are different. So later Shankaracharya will himself change a bit Adhyasa. He will say atasmimstad buddhihi, means something which is not that. Something which is not that. That means cognition of buddhihi, something, cognition of something which is not that. That means cognition of a snake which is not snake. Cognition of water which is not water. So, like that. that will he will do later on. So now we understand that though we say Smriti Rupa, but Smriti Rupa here also means that you have a likeness of that thing, but this thing is not exactly the thing which you are connecting it with. So if you are connecting it with water, it is not water. You are connecting with snake, it is not snake, etc., etc. So now again we can understand this. Once again we can see the definition of adhyasa. Adhyasa, adhyaso nama paratra adhisthane avidyamanasya purvadrishta sajatiyasya arthasya avabhasah. So this is something we can see from a commentary. What is that? That superimposition, adhyasa. You see, adhyasa nama paratra avidyamanasya purvadrishta sajatiyasya avabhasah. What is the meaning? Now that means original definition was Smriti Rupa Paratra Purvadrishta Avabhasaha. Smriti Rupa means recollection. Paratra in a different location. Purvadrishta, what you had cognized earlier, Avabhasaha, same thing. Cognizing the same thing. But if you see the modified thing, definition, then it will be Adhyaso Nama Paratra Adhishthani. That means in a different location. Not just different place, but different location. Avidyamanasya purvadrishta sajatiyasya arthasya avabhasaha. So, in a different location, what do you cognize? Avabhasaha. What do you cognize? Avidyamanasya. Your cognition is of something which is not present. In mirage, water is not present. In the rope, snake is not present. In the shell, silver is not present. So you are cognizing something which is avidyamana, which is not present. And purvadrishta sajatiyasya. So the question will be, how did you cognize something which is not present there? Because of the thing which you have earlier cognized, which is of the similar nature, similar category. Sajati. Sajati means the same category. I saw a tree, now I see a tree. I saw a ball, now I see a ball. I saw a man, now I see a man. So, sajati. Now, this is a category. So, you have seen the category of that thing. And because you have seen the category of that thing in the past, you cognize the same thing. Artha means object here. You cognize the same thing in a different location where that thing does not exist. Now it is becoming clearer. So what is adhyasa? Cognizing something in a different location from what you have seen of the category of the same thing in another location, and you are cognizing it in a location where it does not exist. So just because you have seen ice cream, you had ice cream, then you go any place, even other things appear to be ice cream to you. In childhood, it always happens. Whatever you see, you feel like everything is, oh, this is what. So people, they purchase, they buy mobile phone, or you buy anything. You buy a scooter. Later on, you will see everyone has got that scooter. What has happened? Suddenly, did the company sell scooters to everyone after selling it to you, the same model? No. Everyone had the scooter even before. But you did not relate it with your experience. Now that you relate it with your experience, it appears that everyone has the same brand of mobile phone or scooter which you possess. That's superimposition, you see. So that is why recollection plays such a big role in superimposition. Because we connect with what we have already experienced. If a person who is staying in Calcutta goes to New York, that person will say, yes, in Calcutta also we have such lanes. Why? Because then the person will think, you have come to New York, for God's sake, why are you thinking of Calcutta? But no, this person will constantly refer with Calcutta, because that's the only experience this person has. A globetrotter would not do that. But a person who is first time going, they say, oh, Calcutta also we have. So that's why whenever a person goes new to some place, every time the reference is, oh, in our place also we have this. Oh, this food is there in our place also. Why? Purva Drishta. This recollection or smriti, memory, plays a big role in our perception of things. And that is why it plays a big role in superimposition. So it creates the ground for superimposition. Now this Brahma Sutra Bhashya has been referred to as Prasannam Prasanna Gambhiram. Bhashyam Prasanna Gambhiram. Means which is Prasanna, simple, but Gambhira, profound. So Shankaracharya's language is very simple. As I told you earlier also, Shankaracharya's Sanskrit is very simple. But in simple language, he tells of some profound truths. So here what we have to understand is, why does Shankaracharya talk about Adhyasa? To establish the problem and also to establish that this world is illusory. Now we go to the next section of Adhyasa Bhashya. Matantara Ukta Adhyasa Lakshana Sangraha Bhashyam. That means this is the collection of the superimposition as described by other schools of thoughts. Other schools of thought, they have described superimposition, because superimposition is accepted by all Vedic schools of thought, even Buddhism accepts it. So superimposition, now how other schools of philosophy, how they explain, that is being talked of here. Now we should understand one thing. See, it's a Brahma Sutra is a polemical text. That means here we are going to bring in philosophy, etc. And it is evidenced by the very fact that just after few lines in the introduction to Brahma Sutra Bhashya, Shankaracharya comes to other schools of thought. He is immediately referencing other schools of thought. That means we will be going into other schools of thought. We will be discussing what they talk about, etc., etc. So, as I told you earlier, the more you go deeper and deeper, it will become more deep and more deep. So that's what, deeper and deeper you go, it will become thicker and thicker. So you have to be prepared for that. Tam kechit anyatra anyadharma adhyasah iti vadanti. Tam, that means superimposition. Kechit, some people, means some followers of some other philosophies. Anyatra anyadharma adhyasah iti vadanti. They say, they define it as anyatra, in a different place, in a different locus. Anyadharma adhyasah. Dharma here means attributes. Dharma means attributes. So the superimposition of the attributes of something else in a different place is called Adhyasa, according to some people. Is called Adhyasa according to some people. So so this is actually the position of Vijnanavadi. This is a Buddhist philosophy. So this is the position of Vijnanavadin. We will go and see that, what does it mean and all that. We will see it in detail. Then he says, so some people say that Adhyasa is the superimposition of the attributes of something else on some other location. Iti vadanti, they say like that, they define. Kechit tu can be used as but also. So here but. Kechittu, but others, they say, yatra yad adhyasah tad viveka agraha nibandhanah. Brahma iti. Yatra, where, that means on a particular location, yad adhyasaha, there is a superimposition of something, tad viveka agraha nibandhanaha. Why is the superimposition? Because of the not understanding, agraha, non-apprehension of the viveka, of the difference. So, suppose snake is superimposed on rope, because the difference between snake and rope is not understood. That is why it is superimposed. Okay. And Brahma iti. And also it is what? It is because of illusion or confusion, delusion. Unless you are deluded, how can you see snake in rope? So, superimposition means yatra yad adhyasa, whatever is superimposed, tad viveka agraha. That object's distinction is not understood. So, snake is superimposed on rope. Snake's difference from rope is not understood. Else how there will be superimposition. So, this is, and so it is illusion. So, it is illusion. So, this is also, this is a school of Mimamsa. Mimamsa. Purva Mimamsa or Mimamsa. Which is Prabhakara. Prabhakara means Prabhakara school. So, it is a school of Mimamsa. They hold this view. Anyetu, there are some others who say, yatra yad adhyasaha tasya eva viparita dharmatva kalpanam achakshate. Some people they declare that yatra, wherever yad adhyasa, whatever superimposition is there, means superimposition of an entity is there in some place, tasya eva viparita dharmatva kalpanam. So that superimposition comes why? Because wherever that superimposition is there, regarding that substratum or regarding that location, there is viparita dharmatva kalpana. Means there is assumption or imagination of completely opposite attributes. So instead of seeing rope, which is motionless, you see snake, which can move. Instead of seeing rope, which is non-living, you see snake, which is living. So, yatra yad adhyasa hai, on rope, snake is superimposed. That happens because on the substratum. What is the substratum on rope, snake superimposition? What is the substratum? Rope is the substratum. What is the basis on which superimposition is made? Rope is the basis. It is the substratum. So, instead of seeing the true attributes of rope, viparita dharmatva kalpanam, the opposite attributes of that thing are seen. So, this is also the definition, this is a definition of Nyaya. Nyayikas, Nyaya school of philosophy. They tell like that. So, achakshate, declare. Then, sarvatha apitu, but in all cases, anyasya, anya dharma, avabhasatam, na vyabhicharati. So, Shankaracharya says, whatever these people may say, one thing is clear. What is it? Anyasya, anya dharma, avabhasatam. So, you see, you have the cognition, avabhasa, of one thing having the dharma of another. So you see that rope has got the quality of snake. You see that desert or tar road has got the quality of water. You see that the shell has got the quality of silver. So one thing has the quality of another thing. So anyatra, anyasya, anya dharma, avabhasatam. So that is cognized. This is what everybody is accepting. Nobody denies that. Na vyabhicharati. And so the superimposition is not transgressed here. Means this is not, this point is not denied by anyone. That is the idea here told. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat.